Hey book nerds, welcome to my channel. So this is going up super, super late. But today I'm going to talk about my best and worst books of 2019. Yes, I'm very disorganized in filming this. These were originally going to be separate videos, but I'm combining them because I'm sick of filming content, like wrap-up content from 2019 and also goal content from 2020, because it's the end of January and I'm still doing it. So I'm combining these two, and I'm also gonna do a surprising and disappointing list, which I'll combine those two as well. So to clarify, these are obviously the best and worst books of the year. I have 10 best books. I only have 7 worst books, which I count as a success. And these are different. The best and surprising ones are probably the closest in terms of what they represent, because a lot of the surprising ones would be my best ones if I made like a top 20 or something like that. Whereas the disappointing ones are very different from the worst ones, because the disappointing ones might still have got a good rating overall, but they weren't what I hoped they would be. So that is the setup. I'm gonna start with worst. I'll alternate, so I'll go worst, best until I run out of worst ones. So I can end the video on a positive note. So yeah, without any further ado, let's get to it. A lot of my worst list are actually arcs, and I feel really badly about that. And also, just before I show you this book, I'm gonna work my way up to the best and also to the worst one. So this is like the least worst one. They're not officially ranked, and they're not officially in any order, but the last ones will be my favourite ones or my least favourite ones. So my first worst book is The Doctor by Nic Stone. This is a thriller. It's awful. It is about a, it says it's about a woman who lives next door to a man who's a doctor, and she's not sure if he's evil or not. But you learn immediately that he is evil, and he is the most evil person who has ever lived. Like, walking down the street, he thinks about kicking puppies. He's that kind of evil. It was just frustrating to read from his point of view because it was so over the top, and I skipped, so I didn't technically read the whole of this book. I read the first 15 chapters and then skipped to the last 5, and it was like I had not missed anything in between those chapters. I could follow exactly what had happened. So yeah, not a good thriller. My first best book of the year is If We Were Villains by ML Rio, and this is literally like the first book I read in January last year, I think, or like the second one or something like that. This is also a thriller. It's very poetically written. It is about a group of teenagers who attend a school that is specifically an acting school for Shakespeare. So very, very specific niche group of people. They all kind of talk and act in a very pretentious way, but it works because of the setting. And it's basically the main character is Oliver, and he was arrested for murdering one of the other people, and he's just gotten out of prison, and the detective who was in charge of the case has come to him, and he's a retired detective now, and he said, look, you've served the time for this crime, but I don't think you did it. Can you tell me what actually happened before I die, because I would like to know? And Oliver's like, yes, I will tell you this tale. So he tells the tale, and it's amazing. It's so good. I loved this. Yeah, just fantastic writing, really beautiful story, got a lot of things that I love, and I think I'd like to reread it soon because it was that good. But yeah, definitely check it out if you haven't already. Our next worst book of the year is Made You Up by Francesca Zappia. This I really wanted to like. Again, it was pretty much a DNF. I read about 20 chapters and then stopped, and then read the end, and it wasn't worth it. This is about a girl with schizophrenia. I was super excited to read this for that reason. But the writing style is just very weird. The main character is weird, and not weird because of the disorder. That's not what I mean by that. Just like the way she reacted to things, and it's hard to explain, but no one in this book acted like a real person, and it was very disjointing. The writing wasn't particularly good, which is a shame because there's another book by this author, I think it's Eliza and Her Monsters, that everyone loves, and I really wanted to read it, and now I'm not so sure because I hated this book so much. But yeah, it was just not for me, sadly. My next best book of the year is one of two non-fiction books on this list, and it is Paperback Crush by Gabrielle Moss. I read this right at the end of the year, gave it 5 stars, absolutely loved it. This is basically about the teenage girl fiction of the 80s and 90s. So it covers kind of babysitter club type stuff. It also covers some point horror stuff, but more importantly, it kind of chronologically says about the trends of that era and how it fitted into what society was thinking at the time. This was just a really fun read. It was so well written. It was really interesting to me learning about all these different books. And yeah, I definitely recommend it if you're even remotely interested in the topic area, because it's really good. My next worst book of the year is Cujo by Stephen King. I hated this book. It was so boring. I'm a massive Stephen King fan, but this book is just like... So it's about a dog who goes rabid, but that doesn't happen till like 60% of the way through. And the characters are just not interesting in the slightest. There's loads of side plots, which, unlike in other Stephen King books, they don't really come to fruition and they don't really influence the plot that much. And even when the dog goes rabid, it's pretty boring. It's like the dog is rabid, mauls some people, hours pass, more people show up, the dog mauls them. It's not a good book. This is just really dull. It also has one of the worst examples of gratuitous Stephen King, let's sexually assault some characters that I've ever read. And it just stood out all the more because this book, the rest of this book was so bland that it was like, okay, thanks for that. Thanks, Stephen. Next best book of the year is the other non-fiction one, and that is Queerbaiting and Fandom, edited by Joseph Brennan. This is a collection of academic essays about queerbaiting, which, if you don't know, is the process of getting gay people to invest in your media by suggesting that there may be gay content, but never actually providing the gay content. So the best example is Sherlock. Sherlock and Watson in the BBC one, it's implied that they have a romantic relationship, but that's never actually a thing that happens. It's just a case of, well, if we keep baiting it, then gay people will keep watching because you can't get proper representation, so this is all you get. This is really informative. It covered such a wide range of topics, from TV shows to Eurovision to actual real life celebrities doing this, and I just felt like I learnt so much and it was so informative, so I really loved this book. It's super expensive, sadly, so I can't recommend that you buy it because it's like £40. But if you can get a copy through a library or something, or like an academic library, then definitely do, because it was worth the read. I loved it so much. My next worst book of the year was another ARC, and it was Growing Things by Paul Tremblay. I thought I would love this book so much. It's a collection of horror short stories. I read Head Full of Ghosts earlier, before I read this book, and loved it, but this was just so weird as a collection. It felt like you had to be a Paul Tremblay super fan to understand everything that was going on in every single story. It really wasn't accessible to anyone particularly, and a lot of the stories were related to Head Full of Ghosts, and I still didn't understand it despite having read it like a month before I read this one. It was just badly organised, badly written, it's super long, none of the stories are very good, and they don't stand on their own as stories, and yeah, it was a mess. I did not enjoy this book at all, and it was such a shame. Next best book of the year is Truly Devious by Maureen Johnson. So this is a young adult thriller, I guess? Murder mystery feels more appropriate. Our protagonist is Stevie, and she's a girl who is attending this prestigious boarding school, where it's kind of, I guess, like doing a PhD as your secondary school topic. So everyone who attends there has like a special skill of some description, and they do projects relating to that special skill. And Stevie's is true crime. She has incredible knowledge of all true crime things. And at this school, there was a crime that she is trying to solve that happened years ago, and cool stuff happens. Stevie was like one of the best characters of the year for me. I loved her so much. Still haven't read the sequel, but I need to. And the third one comes out soon, I think in February, January at some point. It's probably already out by now. But yeah, I love this series. It was really fun, really engaging, and I definitely recommend it if you love murder mysteries or great characters or anything along that kind of line. My next worst book of the year was another thriller arc, and it was The Honeymoon by Rona Horsall. This is about a woman who marries a man after knowing him for like a month, and he's really controlling. They go on a honeymoon, but he's lied about the location, and he takes her to a different place where no one knows that she's there. And he kind of like holds her hostage. The reasons I hate this book are numerous. It is fueled entirely by an idiot plot. It kind of justifies abusive relationships in parts, which is not okay. Our main character at one point has the option to be free from this guy, and she stays, and she doesn't stay in the typical, you know, abusive relationships are hard to leave, that's a thing that happens. She just literally goes back to find out why he did things to her. And it's really dumb, it's so stupid. Like, the main character's an idiot, the guy she marries is an idiot, the entire plot is stupid, like, it's just so bad. It's really, really bad. Yeah, don't read it, it's not worth it. My next best book of the year is Kill Creek by Scott Thomas. This is another one I read right at the start of January. It's a horror book about... Oh, it's so good. Right, so there's a haunted house, the house at Kill Creek, and four horror authors, which all represent kind of real-life horror authors. So there's like a stand-in for R.L. Stein, there's a stand-in for Stephen King, there's like a female author who writes really gory, sexy, slasher type stuff, and like a author who writes eldritch abomination type things, who's like super old and super famous and respected by all the other ones. So these four authors go to spend a night in this haunted house for like publicity reasons. Weird stuff starts happening, and it's really great. This is like the perfect book if you're a horror fan. It's got so much content that is just brilliant nods to horror books and horror authors and all that kind of thing. But it does it in a way, whereas if you didn't know anything about this, you're not missing out. Unlike Growing Things, it's like, if you don't know anything about R.L. Stein, then you can just read this character who is a children's horror author, and that's fine, you don't need to know more than that because the book tells you about his character. And yeah, it was so well written, I loved it so much. I definitely recommend it. It is one of my favourite horror books of all time now. The next worst book of the year for me was a thriller arc, and it was The Stranger Inside by Laura Benedict. Again, this is a plot fueled by idiots. A woman comes back from a vacation and someone else is living in a house, and there's no proof. There's like, he's got a deed that she signed the house over to him and she sold it to him, but she didn't do that. In literally in chapter 5, which is about 30 pages into this thing, she proves without a doubt that he is not who he says he is, and he doesn't have the actual deed to her house, so she can just literally kick him out with the police, get back to her home, get back to her life. And instead she says she's gonna let him keep living there because she wants to know why he's doing this and what he's doing. And that whole book was just downhill from there, really, because I don't know what world someone would rather be homeless than and find out the truth than just have their house back and put the whole horrible ordeal behind them. So yeah, it was just really bad. The stuff beyond that wasn't good. The solution was, I think, quite obvious from what I remember. But yeah, I just couldn't get over that. I hate idiot plots. It's a stupid way to create tension in a thriller, and it was not done well here. My next best book of the year was Odd One Out by Nic Stone. Oh, this book, guys, I love it so much. This is a young adult contemporary, basically a romance story, kind of based around friendship. And we have three characters. I don't remember their names because I read this back in March and it's been a while. But we have a guy who is in love with his female best friend. His female best friend identifies as a lesbian, and he knows this, but he's in love with her anyway. And then this new girl joins the school and their friendship group, and both of them fall in love with her. And it's just this beautiful love triangle where it's actually like a proper triangle. And just the representation of this book was fantastic. It raises some really intelligent questions, and it was almost perfect. I have issues with the ending, which I will link my reviews down below for these books, and you can read it if you don't mind spoilers with my issues with the ending. I'm not going to go into it here. But it was almost perfect, and yeah, I loved it so much. It was the book I didn't know that I needed in my life, and I got it, and I'm so happy. So yeah, it's such a good contemporary. I would definitely recommend it. And my final worst book of the year, so the last time I'm going to be negative in this video, is Frankissstein by Jeanette Winterson. This book made me so angry. It's a really prestigious book. It was up for loads of awards, and I think it actually won any of them. And she's a famous feminist author. This book is pretty transphobic, guys. Yeah, so I'm going to link my review down below because it's easier than just going into it here. But essentially, it's a retelling of Frankenstein using, there's some bits about like sex robots in it, and also some bits about uploading your identity virtually, which could be a really cool concept. This is why this book made me so angry, because it could have been fantastic. And there is a trans character in it, and they are dating, he's dating Dr. Frankenstein, Victor. But Victor is specifically interested in him because he's a hybrid, and there's this weird sexualization of the genitals of a trans person, and it tries to blend being non-binary and being trans in a way that implies that you are not a real man if you're a trans man. And it's very frustrating to read because it could have done it so well and it doesn't. And it's just a shame because, yeah, obviously I'm not trans, so I can't comment on this issue, but I ran it past a couple of my trans friends to check that I wasn't reading it wrong, and they supported my view. Obviously do your own research, listen to trans people. But yeah, this book made me very sad and very angry, and yeah, I did not enjoy it at all. So now all the negativity's out the way, let's get on with the best books of the year. So the next best book is Violet by Scott Thomas, who's the same author who did Kill Creek. This is another horror book, and it is about a woman who suffered a tragedy when she was a child. I think she lost her mother, if I remember correctly. And more recently, her husband has died. So she's got her daughter, and both of them are kind of grieving the loss of their husband/father. And kind of having a breakdown, she takes her daughter to her childhood home, which has fallen into disarray. It's all derelict and has not been taken care of. And they kind of build it back up and start to live there. But while they're living there, her daughter starts talking about an imaginary friend, and it is the same imaginary friend that our main character had as a child. That's kind of all I'm going to say about the plot. It's really good. It's slower than Kill Creek by quite a lot. There's less action, but it's character focused, and it does it in such a great way that it feels perfectly paced still. It doesn't feel like you're reading a slow book, it just feels like it's paced just right for this kind of story. It's just a different kind of story. But yeah, I really loved this. It had such great elements. It sounds very similar to Imaginary Friend by Stephen Chbosky, but I liked this one way, way more. I thought it did the imaginary friend concept a lot better. Yeah, it was just really good. I cannot wait to see what Scott Thomas comes out with next, because both of his books have been huge wins for me. And yeah, he's definitely one of my favourite authors now. Following that, we have The Perfect Wife by J.P. Delaney. This was one of the few 5-star thrillers for me. I didn't even have to think about giving it 5 stars. It was definitely a 5-star thriller. So this is about a woman who wakes up, and she is an artificial intelligence cyborg version of herself, basically. So She's no longer human. She has been dead for 5 years. And she wakes up and she's in this body, but to her it seems like she's human. And her husband is keeping things from her. And that's kind of all I want to say about the plot. There's a lot that goes on here. There's a lot of different elements. It flashes back to before when she was still human and things that were happening there. This book surprised me, and it surprised me multiple times in really cool ways. And it was just, yeah, it was so good. The writing was great. The resolutions were great. It was really interesting. And I realised that I really like thrillers with a sci-fi twist. It felt like a really cool way to explore the AI concept. And it doesn't do anything new in terms of, like, science fiction has been doing this for years. You know, you're a robot version of yourself. That's not a new concept. But turning it into a thriller feels like a new concept to me, and that's what I really enjoyed. So yeah, it was definitely my best thriller of the year. Yeah. The next two books are, or the last two books rather, kind of joint in their rating. They're both my favourite books of the year. The first one I'm going to talk about is Sadie by Courtney Summers. Courtney Summers has been one of my favourite authors since like 2013, and when everyone was raving about this book I was so happy because I was like, it's gonna be good. And it was good. So this is, it's not really a thriller. People describe it as a thriller, but I think that gives you misconceptions about the tone of the book. I would describe it as a contemporary, like gritty contemporary. This is about our main character, Sadie, who is hunting down the killer of her younger sister, Mattie, who died, was murdered. And it alternates between Sadie hunting down this killer and chapters about a podcast who are always one step behind Sadie, kind of trying to work out what happened to her because she's gone missing, you know, she's run away. This is just such a beautiful story. It like ripped my heart to pieces. People say, so Courtney Summers always writes open endings, and this is somewhat of an open ending, but it's less open-ended than her other books, so a lot of people dislike the ending. You should maybe be aware of that going in. I think if you know that it's going to be an open style ending, then your expectations are a little different, which is why as well I say don't explain it as a thriller, because of a thriller the point is to get answers, whereas with Courtney Summers' books it's not about the answers, it's about the people and the effect that things have on them. But yeah, this is a beautiful book. I actually listened to the audiobook as well. I read it twice this year, and the audiobook is very good, but I do prefer the physical book, and I'm in the minority with that. But just being able to process the beautiful writing, it just works so much better for me if I can see it and not hear it. But yeah, this is such a good book. Everyone loves it for very good reason. And my best book of the year will probably surprise no one, Radio Silence by Alice Oseman. This book is just, never has a book actually spoken to me so strongly. This is a beautiful story about a girl who is in sixth form, and she's a high achiever, and she's going to go to university to do her degree, because that's what you do. But she loves doing fan art for this podcast, and she meets the creator of the podcast, and they become friends, and it's just such a good story. It's beautiful. I can't explain how great it is, but just like the writing and the themes and the characters and the representation and all of it, it's just, yeah. This book is, I just want to give it to every single person I know who has like anxiety and the urge to achieve and all that stuff. And I'm just like, please read this book, because yeah. Anyway, Radio Silence is my favourite book of the year. Unsurprisingly, yeah, I hope you enjoyed this list. Sorry it's going up so late. Thank you so much for watching this video. Let me know if you've read any of these, if you have different opinions on the ones I hate or the ones I love, or like any other thoughts, if any of them are on your favourite books or worst books of the year. Then yeah, do let me know. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please give me a thumbs up, it helps me out massively, and I hope to see you next time.